All right, so let's continue this reasoning, this special lecture, not series on Ritua Haimanot, which in the Ethiopic means the correct faith or the true faith, the true faith of Ainai Rastafari, where we go to the root of Ainai culture, and that's through the language, the old sense, and that's based on the teaching of His Imperial Majesty. That language is a key, you understand, is a key of culture. So it's that language, and it's all very scriptural too, a fulfillment, prophetic fulfillment of the word of the prophets, where we read in the prophet Zephaniah. And let's go there. We were still in Psalm 23, so let's just finish up Psalm 23. The Lord is I and I shepherd, Psalm. Yahweh is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. My soul. What is the soul? What is the soul? How do you define just to yourself what soul is? What is soul? See, that's very important, because otherwise you're using the word with no knowledge. There's no reference point behind the word when you say soul. Most people might think of a feeling. Oh, it's something that you feel like, it's, you know, soul, like when I'm happy, you know, my soul. But what is your soul? You see, the soul in the Greek is psuche, or what you might know as the word psyche, right? And now much of the soul logic, or the study of the soul, is according to the European, the Gentile, like Freudian speculation. All right, Freud is one of the high priests of soul talk, of soul logic, or otherwise known as psychology. However, I don't know if Freud was smoking any cannabis or whatnot, whether Freud used cannabis, but he wasn't using cannabis in a Christ consciousness. But some things he did disclose, on a certain level. The shame is that a lot of the people of the church have not done their due diligence to preach and teach, first of all, to learn these things so that they could preach and teach, to learn them and to walk in them and experience them so that words would have power. You understand, communicating the truth to people. The soul is the mind, is the feeling, the emotion, the thought, and it's the will. You understand? Those five words are all used in reference to the soul. You understand? So the soul, when the Bible says heart, it is speaking of what we call today the conscious, the conscious or the consciousness. You understand? Usually when it's speaking within the parabolic sense of the Psalms, or the figurative, when it uses this figurative language, you have to describe something that's more metaphysical, seemingly in its reality, is spiritual in its reality. He restores my mind state. He restores my feelings. My feelings aren't all mixed up. I'm not all like I need, you know, like something's wrong with me, like a bipolar kind of. Christ, Yeshua, can restore one's soul until they no longer need even the bipolar pharmakesis sorcery. But in all, the key is the faith. See, the key right there is the Amen. So he restores my soul, my feeling, my thought, my will. This is what's interesting, that the soul also compasses the will. For those who want to get into this study and learn this for themselves a little bit deeper, I would suggest that they go to page 1270 of the Schofield Reference Bible, and page 1270, which is Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. There's a footnote down here, and it says this briefly. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, I'm looking in the Schofield study Bible, reference Bible here, and it says, man a trinity. Man is a trinity, right? Man is a Selassie. Man is a trinity. That the human soul and spirit are not identical is proved by the facts. by the facts, not the speculation, not the theories, not the belief, not the assumptions, but by the facts that they are divisible. They can be divided. The soul can be divided from the spirit, so they're not one and the same thing, but they have a relationship. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, and that the soul and spirit are sharply distinguished in the burial and the resurrection of the body. Now, it goes into a little bit deeper, but then it says down here midway in the paragraphical, it says that the soul is the seat. The soul is the seat, or we could say the throne on a certain level. The soul is the wenber, and that's, or wenber, member. It says the soul is the seat of the affections, the desires, and so of the emotions, and of the active will. The active will, the will that we activate, which is the self. The self. And this is according to the Schofield notes right here. And that's very accurate and interesting. It translates perfectly and is in perfect agreement, because the self is the ras. The ras is the self. You understand? We say rase, inda rase. You understand? As myself, or like myself. All right? The self. So, the act of will, the emotions, the affections, the desires. So when David, or rather when Yeshua says, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, what is he saying? He is saying that my soul, my affections are in a state of sorry. My desires, in a state of sorry, my emotions, my feelings, you understand, my act of will, myself. You know, so we know self in this Western Gentile culture by the Greek and the Latin, especially by the Latin, we call it the ego, lego of my ego, or ego. Really, more correctly, it's the ego, you understand, but the ego. Now, that in itself is very, very interesting, the fact that it's connected with the ego, the self. So that's also connected with the soul. And in the more professional of psychiatrists and medicine, they call it the psuche, or the psyche. Like, you have a psychological, when it's a psychological disorder, is basically a soul disorder. Mm-hmm. If somebody has a psychological disorder, they have, according to the scriptures, according to the teaching, they have a soul disorder. Something wrong with their ego, something affecting their will, something affecting their emotion, something affecting their desires, what they desire. A person has desire for something that they know are wrong. There's some soul defect. You'll say that only Christos, only Yeshua and His Word, and through the Holy Spirit, can restore that soul and lead it in the path of righteousness, of tzedek, of the zadok, or zadok, or tzedek, the tzedek, for His name's sake. For His name's sake. And now the fullness for His name and His Son's name. The Lord, because the evildoers set themselves, according to Psalm 2, against the Lord and His Messiah. And His, against the Father and the Son. They hate the Father and Son. And David intimated it in the Tehillim, in the Mezmor Dawit. He intimated, he spoke on these things, right? He spoke very, very clearly about these things. But folks were lost in translation. You have to remember that the scripture was not originally revealed in English. That does not mean it cannot be understood or overstood in English, but it requires study. It requires that investment. It requires one taking interest in it in order to earn, like those dividends, or earn anything out of it. It's very clear. You understand? So even here in the Old Testament, we have it speaking of the Moshiach, because it was known of the Moshiach to come in that, after that 5,500 years. Even in this document here, we haven't had the opportunity to get into this particular document, the Gedula Adam, the conflict or the combat of Adam and Eve against Satan. It was in one of our precious Ethiopian documents right here, because it actually fills in a lot of the missing pieces in Gentile Christianity or Western Christianity that was known since the first century and even before. This is why we find books like Jubilees and Enoch and even the Gedula Adam finding their way in the New Testament. That means the people of the New Testament, the apostles and the disciples, they knew this. These documents were part of their true diary or so-called library, all right? And they need to become part of our library or true diary again. They said if you want to hide something, just put it in the book, right? Mm-hmm. And there's nothing that can be truer than that concerning what we're speaking about right here. Verse 4 says, yea, though the yea is not really there in that sense, but the context, the translatable, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Now, the real context of this is really Egyptian. Now that's bothersome, folks. It's really Kemetian. That really is going to bother some people. But let me say it another way. The context of this is according to the ancient Afro-Shemitic mythologies. You understand what's called the mythology or parables. You understand? It's according to a certain worldview, which unfortunately is not Eurocentric, so a lot gets lost in translation. So that yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, though we are in the world but not of the world, I will fear no evil. See, he hasn't given us a spirit of fear in sonship, in adoption, in the legionet. We haven't been given a spirit of fear, but of peace, love, and what? A sound mind. Soundness or healthiness of our mind state, which means of our soul state, because he has restored it, because he's our shepherd, because we have made our wills obedient to good influences, and we're being guided. You understand? And we're being faithful and therefore true. And there's no weapon against the truth. For thou art with me. Thou art with me. Who? The shepherd. Yahweh. I and I shepherd is with I, is within I, and I, and I. For thou art with me, with I, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort I. Now, there's a whole lot of talk about the rod and the staff and so on, beating your kids and stuff like that. And maybe that should be another video right there about beating. People say, yeah, you gotta beat kids. And when I grew up, I was beat. You know, and a lot of that's just the abuse of Satan, the confusion that has continued. It became a tradition. So a lot of things are done traditionally. And Christ, one thing very clear about Christ and very conflicting about modern-day Christians is that they do a lot of things in tradition which contradict the teaching of Christ, which contradicts the word of Christ. And if you were to judge them based on the authority of their religion, they would have to be judged as anti-Christ, not consciously, but even being deceived by that same old deceiver, all right? But the rod and the staff, when we say it's Egyptian in context, we're talking about the flail and the crook. You understand? We're speaking about those particular items of kingship. But when you start to understand the flail and the crook is the shepherd's crook, and the flail, which is the one that has the thongs and it's the beater. Some say the beater, law and order. But really, it is what you thresh out the grain with. All this comes from the ancient agricultural. As it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end. And once again, check out I and I, brethren, hempireworks.com. You understand? And get to be a part of the movement, support the movement, check out the radio show, because the brethren and those others who are also working in those same ways, they have it right. It's about agriculture. So we say culture right here, and let's update this right here. We're going to put, it's not just culture, but what kind of culture? It's a agree culture. It's not a disagreeable culture. It's a agree culture. If you want to deal with word, sound, and powers on that level in the English language, well, it's a agree culture. It's agriculture. And it's agricultural. That's why the rod and the staff is there. Now, the rod and staff that we have in ancient Egypt, they have deeper meanings, which are embedded in this word here. It's embedded in the Bible, but if you're not coming from that Afro-Shemitic perspective, and it's coming from a so-called European or a worldly perspective, this is where there's a lot of getting lost in translation. This is why there are so many denominations, there's so many sects, they don't agree. They all say that they worship the same God, but they can't even get together, they can't pray together, they can't work together, they all are vying at each other. And that is directly contradictory to his word. He says, you can tell who are my disciples by how much, he didn't say you can tell who are my church members. He said you can tell who are my disciples by how much love they have one for another. You see, so it's not about being so much a church member. That's why we change the membership in that sense more to a discipleship application, so that ones would begin to become conscious about being a disciple and a follower of Yeshua HaMashiach according to the teaching, the pure teaching of His Imperial Majesty Kedemawi HaILE SELASSIE first. Alright, we'll get into the rod and the staff at another time. You understand? But we gave you the reference points right there. Verse 5 and 6 to complete this Psalm 23, Psalm 2-3, thou, you male. Now, see, in the English, you don't really see the thou there. You can pretend it's anything you want. You know what I'm saying? But in the true context, it is you male. So there's also a gender that is lost in translation. There's divine harmony of the male and the female gender, and we find that through our true culture and through the language, the linguistic keys. That's why it says, I have the keys of David. This is why the one who sits on the throne of David can say, I have the keys of David. What he opens, nobody can close. What he closes, nobody can open. He has the keys of David. You understand the keys of David? He who is of the root and the offspring of great King David, or DVD, or Dawit, right? Or Tahuti, if you please. Verse 5 says, thou preparest a table, a gebeta, a table. Now, remember we talked about the tabernacle over here? We mentioned the tabernacle over here. There's a table here. You know what I'm saying? There's the table of the shewbread, or the bread of the face, the bread of the presence. You know what I'm saying? There's a table of bread, and it has 12 loaves there for the 12 tribes of the Beit Israel, but also for the true 12 disciples of Yeshua HaMashiach, as well as for the 12 powers, which the disciples symbolize when we get on the more spiritual level of really walking out the way. You know, it comes to more maturity, the high school and the university level of our discipleship. So it says, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. In the presence of mine enemies. That communion table. Remember what the communion table is. We call it Aital. It used to be the Aital sup. What happened to the Aital sup? Now there's the Aital sup. Everybody got to pay for the plate. I mean, what is going on? Oh, you're fundraising. Fundraising or fundraising? What's going on? Where does he teach us about doing stuff like that? What about his way? What about his life? You understand? The way, the truth, and the life. What about it? He prepared the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head, Rasay. My Ras, not the Jamaican Ras, let's understand, not that Jamaican, the Ras actually in Patois means the bumba, means the keep, you know, it's the keep actually, it's the buttocks, you know, your Ras cloth, it's like a butt cloth. So we have to clarify that. You have to choose. You want to live in the Patois, you understand, or you want to move forward in the way, the the truth, and the life of the King of Kings and His Christ. The choice is yours. The King has already told you, make your will obedient to good influence and what to do and how to get there. You understand? You have to redeem the time. Time is of the essence. Thou anointest my head with oil. Oil, once again, being symbolic of the Holy Spirit. So one is truly in a spiritual consciousness if one understands the symbols here, even in the Psalms. You understand? The Psalm says, with oil, with the Spirit, even the Holy Spirit, my cup runneth over. My cup runneth over. That means one has more than enough to give to others of what Jah has given to you. You understand? Because Jah is not limited by a bad economy or the economic trouble in Europe or something like that. He's not limited by that. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Yes, the enemies have done all this because we were sleeping. You understand? We did not wake up and despise their image. You understand? But we were sleeping. You understand? Verse 6 says, but now awake, O God. Judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. It says in verse 6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Right? Shall follow me. Look at that. In your wake is goodness. You understand? Charitableness, charnet, open-handedness, generosity, and mercy. Right? Shall follow me all the days of my life. All the days of my life. Now, it's interesting when you read that part there in the goodness, you see the word that's similar to Noah, Anoch, which also means like the Ankh, which means long life. So the connection between Ethiopia and her colony from ancient times, Egypt, is very evident in there. These Psalms, indubitably, you understand, are much older in their core context than people would even want to believe or acknowledge as true. That doesn't take away from what the Hebrews have done. In fact, it really says hallelujah and amen to what the Hebrews preserved. They preserved the truth from ancient Egypt. The problem is, you're trying to understand it in a Gentile, white, Western, Eurocentric concept instead of as Rastafari, going to your root and your truth, but most of all, being obedient to the teaching of His Majesty. That's the core element right there. You understand? Whether one holds the name in spirit and in truth, or just hold it as a style, a fashion statement, or whatever, you're going to be burnt out after a while. You understand? How do I know? It is written. You understand? Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of Yod-Heh-Wow-Heh-For-Iver. I will dwell in the house of Yahweh, of Jah, if you please, forever. For-Iver. Iska-Zalalem. Right now, the Holy Spirit reminded me of something. The Mensis Kedus, as I was going through this, and let's see if I can recall it, bring it to the frontal lobe right here on James. Let's go to James in the New Testament. Yaakov, right? Let's go to Jacob, James in New Testament. I think it appears a couple of times in the Bible. The word religion. The word religion appears a couple of times, and the reason why we want to go here, you understand, is to kind of like feel the fullness of this particular message on religion from the scripture, right? From the scripture. Now, what we want to do also is to bring into exhibit the Metaf Kedus, right? The Revised Amharic Bible of His Majesty, the Book of the Seven. See it right there, the seven seal, right? The Metahafik Kedus, right? The Metaf Kedus. And we want to share with you what the pure language of the King of Kings and His Christ has to say about this matter. And, you know, go over it so that hopefully one will get a basic idea, you understand, a basic idea, right? As well as get the right ID, the right identification of the matters that are spoken of here. So we're going to go to James, which is Jacob, which is Yaakov, And also heal up I and I, brother Yaakov. We have a reason in the moment with eyes and I and I, heart and mind and I and I prayers. And shalom to the eyes, Rastafari home. Amen. Yes, I. So let's go through verse 26. Now, the Schofield said the test of true religion. So if we think we got true religion, we need to test it to make sure it is, and we're not hoodwinking, deceiving, and bamboozling ourselves. All right, so there's a test, right, of true religion. It says, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. This man's religion is vain. And this is verse 26. It says, Andebetun saigata libun iasate egziavi herin yemiya melika yemiya meslo manam binor ye ursu amliko kentun. Now, here it uses the word amliko. Now, this is very good that we're touching on this, right? Because I said that this is Haimanot. Haimanot is in the scripture as well, right? Even in the Mitmanot, which means those translated believers, but the faithful ones, those who have Amen. The word Amliko, and some of you, if you're familiar with some of the world Amharic and the Amharic language, you know that Amlak is one of the words which usually is translated as God. You understand? As God, or quote, the divine, right? The divine in translation. Here it's using the Gerun, speaking a little bit, this is kind of like what the linguistic folks and the people who be in the studies and stuff, they use these words to describe different parts of the word, the Gerun of the word. It's similar to the sense of, how can I give you an example? If we say Gebba means to enter, Gebbeto, having entered. It's in that sense, like having entered. It can be translated as having entered. So, Amalika in the sense, you would mean to regard as divine, to regard as God, to regard something. It comes down to the word worship. It comes down to the word worship. So there's a difference between religion in our Ethiopic sense and even worship. The word Haimanot is there in the scripture, and I got this for the English level of it because it's translated in King James Version as religion. Bamarinya, what is now speaking to us, it says andebetun. It says the one who don't bridle their tongue. The word andebet mean your style of speech, how you speak. Let me give you an example. It doesn't mean don't talk, don't speak it, don't preach it, don't articulate it, don't describe. No. It's not talking about bridling or something like that. It's about bridling your style of speech. You know, some of us in our style of speech, we can use some language or ways of saying things that are more traditional to ourselves. Sometimes it can be also more sarcastic or hurtful or other ways, and we know we do it, but it's our style of speech. That's how I speak. But in true worship of the divine, of Yahweh, of Jah, we must grow up. You understand? We must grow. That means we must change that which does not conform to His will, to His truth. You understand? So it's saying here that andebetun sai geta. Geta means to constrain. As a message, to constrain the love of Christ, the love of God. It constrains all of us who are followers and disciples to do all in our power to see to it. You understand? That those who have not heard the good news can hear the good news. You understand? So it says here, andebetun sai geta, our style of speech, sai geta, while not restraining. Let me give you an active sense. It's like when you're riding a horse and you're holding the reins of the horse and you pull it back and you restrain it. Okay. Or a dog, if you have a dog on a leash, like that picture I love of this Matthew. I don't know if any of you have got this picture where Matthew's holding like his dog, one of his dogs, and it looked like a pit bull. It seemed like a pit bull, and the dog seemed like it's going the other way, and his match is holding it there, like, you know, like a so-called little strong man. That he's a big strong man, but you can't judge by appearances, but people do. You know, that's the foolishness of the idiotes. But anyway, that particular picture, if you have it, you know, share it or something like that, or send it forward, hit the contact, attach it or whatnot. You know, make I not know if you have that particular picture, if you know the picture, but how his match is holding that dog. It's like the dog wants to get at something. We all know it's outside the frame of the picture. The dog wants to get at something, and His Majesty is like holding the leash of the dog, so he is restraining it. You know, of course, if he will, if it's necessary, he'll let the leash go and let the dog get at whatever it is, but he's restraining it. It's like our style of speech. This is the reason why I apologize about that vid that I put up there. Not because it didn't need to be said and all of that, not because it so much wasn't true or all of that, but because of the present work that we should be about, you understand, on this channel and the present work that we have set out to be about. So I apologize about my undebit, as David would say, right? And he even says other things about his undebit that are interesting, but it means that we have to check our words, word, sound, and power, the words we use, just like on the level of Rastafari, nostalgic folk Rastafari, where we wouldn't say certain things like you and me, we would say I, so our style of speech, we are restraining it from saying and speaking in certain ways, you understand? So this is what it's saying right here about restraining one's, bridling their tongue, restraining their style of speech. It says, libun iyasate, he is deceiving his lib, but moreover his consciousness, because his consciousness is supposed to be grown up to Christ. You understand? That's why it says the fool has said in his heart, there is no God, because he does not treasure and store that word in his heart, that is to say his consciousness. Because if the word is now in your heart and you meditate on it, something that you say, you're going to change, those things so that the light of Christ can move through you without any obstruction. You understand? And with any destruction. You understand? So it will be constructive, in other words, and not destructive. So, libun iyasate. He deceives his own consciousness. Because in truth, that's what I'm saying, is true worship. Remember, worship. Egeziabi herin, the Ethiopic name for Yahweh, the name of Yahweh before the world was created, according to Sene Begolgata, right? Egeziabi herin, Yemiya Melik, one who worships the sustainer, one who gives a worth and a value to John, to the God and Father, our Black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christos. Yemi Meslo, you understand? One who seems as though they worship Ixiavia. One who seems as though they worship Jah or they worship God. You know, you might know all about a person, but it seems like they do, right? Yemi Meslo says, Manam Binor, whoever it may be, whoever it is, Manam Binor, Yarsu Amliko Kentu No. You know what? His religion, his giving value to the true God, to the God and Father of our Black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, his worship or worship is kentu, is vain. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. It is vain. It's like nothingness. It's worthless. It has no value. It's like in Hebrew, the word vain means it's not kentu, but it's hevel. Hevel is actually a, it's like a puff of air. You know, it's like, it's a man's life is like, it's like a hevel. You understand? And that's what it's like. It's like, it's like a short breeze, right? Now, in the next verse, which King James translates verse 27 of the general epistle of James, or Yaakov, chapter 1, verse 27, it says, pure religion or worship, and undefiled, not defiled, that means it's not orkus, It's not rikus. It's not cheap. It's not devalued. When it says something unclean, it means it's cheap. It has no spiritual value. You understand? It's like something that doesn't have any material value you regard as being cheap or worthless. So spirituality that doesn't have any value, you don't invest in it. It's nothingness. You don't want to even contaminate yourself with it. You understand? So it says right here that pure religion or worship and undefiled before God and the Father. In other words, the one who is God and the Father of who? The Father of Yeshua HaMashiach, the one who Yeshua testifies to in this Wangel, in this gospel, in this good news, who we see in a Rastafari revelation being revealed in the person of Edomawi Haile Selassie, or Haile Selassie first, without any apology, but with preaching and teaching of the scripture. You understand? Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this. This is what pure worship, you understand? Pure worship is. To visit the fatherless, the one who don't have Abba. You understand? To visit them with the word. You understand? To visit them. You understand? And widows in their affliction. In their affliction. It's interesting that they don't say to visit the motherless. Now, some will say, oh, that's where the Bible sex is. No, you don't really get it. You really don't get it. They want the baby mama drama. That's why the scripture says fatherless. It says fatherless. So what we're seeing working out in the world is a part of that plan from the very beginning. You're going to stop the divine seed, that race. You're going to break down ones and ones to destroy the family. We can say the black family. You're going to, but really overstanding the holy family. You're using that holy paradigm of family, mother, father, and child, or father, mother, and child, or children at time, right? So it says, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Unspotted from the world, that means we are in the world, but we are not spotted by the world. We're not dirty by the world. Like somebody says, oh, let me get that. Oh, you got some world on you. You got a little bit of world on you right there. You must have rubbed up too close against the world. You spotted. Oh, man, my garment is all. No, to keep yourself unspotted from the world. In other words, be in the world, not of the world. You get that basic thing with it. In the world, not of the world. Now, that verse right here is Nitzu Yohana Nawurin Ye Lelabeta Amluko Le Gziavi Rab Zen Yihinno Wala Jocha Ye Lelacho Win Lejoch Balate Tochne Be Makaracho Mateyek Be Alamima Kamigain Idis So Natun Matabek Matabekno. Interesting here, because I just saw it as I was reading, once I caught it right there, I saw where it says, Wala Joj, ye le la choin, le Joj. In other words, saying that children, le Joj, right, that have no, not father, does it say in the Roman part, but parents, that don't have any parents. Now, this brings I and I to a kind of another connective level right there. And the other parts of the translation were basically the same. I want to just go here where it says to visit the fatherless, right? Really to ask about them. Matayek, to ask, to inquire about those who don't have any parents. Now the King James says that don't have any fathers. So we said it's what they want to do in the world, because the world just knows this translation. You see, I mean, most of those in the world, you know, so many know this translation. I mean, we have so many Bibles that are being written right now, not from the Greek or not from the Masoretic, and definitely not from the Ethiopic or the Royal Amharic, but from the English. It's being like reverse engineered, and we talked about that before. Reverse engineered. Now, let's go to Proverbs for a moment. Proverbs is an excellent book for the disciples. In fact, even those who have gone a little bit past the discipleship level still must remember, you know, one's foundation and still have to go over these areas again so that this sword can stay sharp. You know, the daily psalms, you want to know what to do daily. The daily psalms, chanting the psalms, and also reading and studying the proverbs. You know what I'm saying? And trying to memorize the proverbs. It's very good to memorize that ancient wisdom. But here in Proverbs chapter 1 of Proverbs, verse 8, it says something very interesting. It says, my son, which is, say, lije, which is not when the lije, male child, it says, my child, son or daughter, he pours out his spirit upon the sons and the daughters, according to Joel's tinbeat or prophecy. It says that my child, that's more correct, my child, my lich, hear the instruction, shema the instruction, hear the instruction of thy father. Now, in the Old Testament and in the basic sense, of course, that is a child hearing the instruction of their father, especially their father in the Lord, in Adonai. And hopefully, and this is where things have gone wrong, because here when it speaks to the Hebrews are a covenant people. And since as a covenant people, it's already clearly kind of understood by the terms that they would remain in this covenantal relationship. The scriptures were not meant for the world outside of Beta Israel testimony in Yeshua. But you know, we know what happened to our lost sheeple, don't we? Because of their disobedience, things basically have gotten all twisted, all wicked and everything. If we had been obedient, you know what I'm saying, we would have ministered that from Yeshua's time to the world. You know what I'm saying? To the world. But no, what's happened is that many of us did minister it, and then there was the hostile takeover of Christianity where the blackness was whitewashed out of it. They call it the iconoclast phase and the whitewashing of images, and it's a very interesting part of his story to go over. But hearing the instruction of thy father for us in Yeshua is hearing the instruction of his father. That's why Christ came to be a witness of what? The Father. If you notice, he keeps saying, the Father, my Father, my Father has sent me. It's my Father, and the connection of God being his Father. So the testimony is clear that he came to redeem the true patriarchy. Not the false patriarchy. That false father is based on the devil. You see, so we have, yes, two fathers. We have the devil. You understand? As the Father, and Christ always disclosed that when he said to them, ye are of your father the devil, for he was a murderer from the beginning. If y'all were of my father, and y'all was of Abraham in spirit and in truth, you would love me. But because you seek to kill me, and because they seek to kill Rastafari before it can grow, you understand? It's how we know who they are, because we know they come to steal, to kill, and to destroy, or to steal, to murder, and to destroy. So we know them by their own case history. If we check them out by their own case history and their own priors, if we look at white supremacy, if we look at the world, if we look at the situation, we judge them by their priors. But when you end up on this square, they're going to look into your priors. That's why they want to get your name, your number, all this information about you. But they want to see, they want to run it like a computer, run program, and find out if anything is there. And then that's how they will approach you. So here's saying that we are to hear the instruction of the Father and forsake not the law of thy mother. And forsake. Now that's the most interesting part, the law of the mother and the true conditioning of the Maria. That's one of the reasons why, you know, we're so happy to, you know, to be able to print and publish this right here, right? To print and publish this right here on the Ethiopic legends of Our Lady Mary, the true mother of our Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach. And what's so interesting is the Hebraic Judaic foundation of true Ethiopian Christianity. It's like these are Hebrew peoples who have accepted Yeshua. The way that the Jews, the Old Testament Jews, or the Israelites, the 70 AD Israelites, our people should have accepted it. You know what I'm saying? But we didn't, and we fulfilled that particular prophecy that we have, that foretelling that we have in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 15 to verse 68, and in the other places of Scripture. So we learn more about the law, which is the Torah. And this is what's very interesting, the Torah of our mother. And you know, the Holy Spirit told me to bring this one out too, to show you this one again, Philosophy Anthology. Right, Philosophy Anthology, right here. This work right here, Philosophy Anthology. It's very, very interesting. The Beta Israel, the black Jews of Ethiopia, a.k.a. otherwise known as the Ethiopian Hebrews, you know. But they call themselves Beta Israel. So let's recognize that. All right. Now, this is translated from Ethiopic sources. And what's interesting about the Beta Israel, our indigenous Hebrew, Jewish, Israelite brothers and sisters, is that they view the Sabbath, their view of the Sabbath is interesting, because the Sabbath is viewed in the likeness of a woman or a mother that intercedes for God's people. In other words, it's how they have received it. Now, if you were to hear that, you'd be like, oh, are they worshiping some false goddess or something like that? You'd be like a lot of from a Gentile mind. No. Overstand what it's saying right here. Notice why it says, and forsake not the law of thy mother. What is the law of thy mother? What do the Hebrews mean here in the Proverbs when they say the law of the mother, of thy mother? See, from a Gentile worldview or a Eurocentric perspective, the perspective that most people think, breathe, and act in, it's like a blank. Or it's a wrong, a misinterpretation of it. When you compare that right there to Galatians, where it says that the law was our schoolmaster, you understand, for Christ, or until Christ become, until we are more mature, you understand, until we can come into our messiahship, you understand, it was our Christ consciousness, in other words, be true Christian, be true Christian, for I and Rastafari be faithful and true to the teaching of His Majesty and to the testimony of His Christ. But here we have an example of the father and the mother, of our father and mother. Now, Rastafari, this is a related issue. Hopefully we'll have an opportunity, or others can also reason on this, the whole Empress thing that's going on. And one of our reasons, Mikniya, or reason for putting out this particular document right here, the Ethiopic legends of Our Lady Mary, right, is to help the sisters, daughters, mothers, and wives really begin to examine things from their own root. You understand? And from I and I own truth, because there's a lot of stuff out here, feminism and a lot of other kind of femaleism, goddess kind of stuff out there, and a lot of things getting mixed up, and Jah has given us something greater. So we want to actually do a lecture, and it's called the lecture, Daughters of Ethiopia. And the reason why is because it's an interesting connection between the covenant when the Kingdom of David was renewed in Ethiopia. Now, this is another document right here that actually goes along with it, the Queen of Sheba and the only son, Menelik. So when we look at, well, what has happened to the black woman, the black mother, you understand, what has happened to even our, as males, regard for the black woman, the mother, the whole family. Willie Lynch, we could go to Willie Lynch and How to Make a Slave, and we need to go there because that shows what was done to reverse this original order. And it was this original order, this is what's written on our heart. But so many years of persecution, of brutality, of stealing and murder and destruction has gone on, You know what I'm saying? So that we would live in the image of the beast and not know ourselves, because we would know ourselves. You know what I'm saying? We would overcome, you know what I'm saying, the enemy, and this earth again would be a paradise in the new creation of the heavens and earth. That is still to be. The question is, will we be of that faithful generation? Will we make our wills, do we seek to make our wills obedient to good influences? You understand the good, you know, the good influence of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Some say, well, why don't you say Father, Mother, and Son? Because we're speaking about spiritual things. Now, that has, of course, that bothers some folks and everything like that. But I would say be patient and learn. These documents that we spoke right here, they go into more clarification of it. You will see very clearly that the Mother and the, you know, the Mother was not neglected or avoided in Holy Ethiopia. It's only now that the Mother has been whitewashed, like in a lot of the Mary images. It, I mean, what a lot of Ethiopians don't understand, that these images that they have of Jesus now, that they have whitewashed and replaced, is part of the reason why things are degenerating and getting worse and not better. You understand? Because they, it's like looking in a mirror and seeing somebody else. Suppose you look in the mirror and you see somebody else. How would you feel? Some folks might want that, but for people who don't have that psychological imbalance, that would be shocking. But then if you got used to looking in the mirror and seeing someone else, you understand? This is kind of like what has gone on and why Ethiopia is adversely affected. In other words, they don't see our Mother in her true Ethiopianness. You know, in this level where being black, people have been hoodwinked and bamboozled to think like being black is a crime. It's bad to be black, so they want to, you know, do all these kind of crazy things to change the way that they look. And the Bible tells us that we would live in a time where people would want to live in the image of the beast. You understand? That they would live, they would take the mark of the beast on them. And we're seeing these things manifest on a day-to-day basis. But you have to remember, a lot of folks have sold their souls, you know, and remember we talked about the soul, we try to break down, actually, or really build up on the teaching, not so much always use breakdown. See, that's the undebit thing, undebitun sai geta. You understand? So, you know, have to, you know, constrain that, you know, say, yeah, I'm going to break this down for you. Oh, you're going to destroy it? You know, no, some things we have to build up. Some things we have to break down, but this right here we have to build up. You understand? Because it's very important to the family. You understand? The family. And it answers all these questions about, you know, well, what is the role of the woman and what about the divine mother, so forth and so on. There is a divinity, of course, of our mother and father, of us as a people. You understand? That does not mean that we are, see, a lot of people get this confused. It does not mean that we are trying to be gods. I just want to put that out there. It's not like that New Age stuff that we are gods, we're trying to be God. Now I'm not devolving to be a god. You're devolving into a psychosis. You know, I mean, basically, and you're talking with a fake British accent, too. I mean, I don't really know what's going on right there. No, you can't come in my house. No, I will not bid you Godspeed. Please go. You know what I'm saying? I mean, and please is not bidding them anything. It's saying, you know, would you kindly, you know, would you just go? But anyway, the Mother and the Father and the Mother. So what we see right there in James is very, very interesting, because in James it says that for children that have no parents. You see, there's a lot of Christians today, and a lot of people who come into, you know, the sphere of Christianity, you know, in words, into the sephir of Christianity, more or less. Because some people say, well, they only go to church, but they hold certain teachings or certain things to be true that's based on the scriptures of the Bible. You have to understand the role of the father and the mother there. Because, see, it goes back to Adam Wehewan. It goes right back to that, and then it also affects or defects our relationships with one another and our building the one important, central, key thing, and that is family. And that is family. And that, too, is connected with our true religion, or the ritual Haimanot that the King of Kings teaches us concerning. So that mother-father relationship, the law, Torah, is considered our mother. And this is why this thing, the Mariam, or the true Mary, the Black Madonna, you understand, is considered to be like that living embodiment in that sense, like of the Ark of the Covenant, and the Son, which is the living law, you understand, in spirit and in truth, Yeshua HaMoshiach, being born of her, is like the two tablets of the Ark, because he was the living law. He perfected the law. He showed us how to be in laws, not outlaws, and not so much under law. You understand? Not to be under law. And that reminds me of another area of scripture. I know I'm saying a lot of that reminds me, but it does remind I and I, and hopefully it will also remind others when in the scripture it tells us about law. Here in First Timothy, first epistle of Timothy, it says that there are many who desire to be teachers of the law, teachers of Torah, teachers of even the mundane law, like even the legal system in the world, but they're understanding neither what they say. They don't understand what they say because words are very important. They say this is for loser, but this is for right angle. You understand? This is to angle your speech, right? This is for law, that L. When they do that and call you loser, is that you are under law. It's like a hangman's noose upside down, right? But it says right here, it says, understanding neither what they say nor what they affirm. They don't understand what they say or what they affirm. Like you said, what does Rastafari mean? If one says it means head creator, I understand that they don't understand what they are saying or what they are affirming. They might be doing it in a pleasant, not a negative, evil sense, but they're doing it in an ignorant sense. And that is as worse, that's as bad or worse. Verse 8 says, but I know that the law, remember the law of the mother, that the law is good. The law is good if, the key word, if I and the Father, if a man use it lawfully. The law is good if a man use it lawfully. See, we're not outlaws. When we talk about Babylon, we're talking about the misuse of law. But we cannot really do too much about that misuse if we don't understand or overstand what we say or what we affirm. Right? So the law is good if a man use it lawfully, knowing this, not believing this, not hoping in this, you understand? Not even seeking this, but knowing this, having cognizance of this, that the law is not made for a tzaddik soul. It's not made for a righteous man. That means the law is not really made for a true Christian. You understand? Or in Revelation for Rastafari. The law is not made for us, you understand? But it's made for a lawless, for the lawless and the disobedient. Notice that. The lawless, the Torah-less, right? And the dis-shema. The dis-shema, the ones who dis the shema. They're disobedient. They're dis the shema. They're disobedient. For the ungodly, for those who are not kedush. Those who are not set apart. You understand? Those who are in the world, of the world, they love the world, they go to bed with the world, they wake up with the world, they die with the world. Right? For the ungodly. And for the hatiatenyoch. For the sinners. For the ones who keep missing the mark. Wanty, wanty, yami, yami, licky, licky. You understand? Too, 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 too greedy. For the sinners. You understand? For those who miss the mark. The hatiatenyoch. For unholy. For the unholy and profane, the arkus, for those who have little value for the truth, for the spirit, for job, you understand, for life, you understand, for goodness sake, for murderers, murderer, right? For murderers. That's serious, man. You know, some of us might have been affected by it in our family, or, but that's something serious. You have to understand how serious this is. This is not no joke. You're like, oh, you, if you read the Bible, you're a stupid idiotote. You understand? For real. I mean, they need to do something else with themselves until the time comes. You know, until we be fully grown up. You understand? And though we are servants now, we become heirs of all things in and through Yeshua HaMashiach. Of fathers, they are murderers of fathers, and they are murderers of mothers. Interesting how the Holy Spirit sent me here. I didn't even see that connection right there with the whole fathers and mothers. You know what about true religion? That these ones be visited, in other words, asked and sought concerning. You know what I'm saying? Sought concerning. And it's not just see, a lot of people interpret and say it's just the literal fatherless. But you have to remember that we have to understand these things spiritually. But it begins by understanding, well, what are happening to children don't have a father or a mother? How they're being abused, sold into slavery, sex slavery, doing all sort of dehumanizing, debasing things, you understand, for the pleasure of demon-possessed people. You understand? Murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers for manslayers. Right? You know, people say, oh, no snitching, rah, 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 rah. It's not in a Torah-based community. You know, in a Torah-based community, you better go elsewhere. It's a bad man, bad girl, whatever like that, mad people, you know. We'll deal with you in Yeshua, for Yeshua's sake. For whoremongers, you understand? They want to go whoremongering. There's a lot of other places for them to go whoremongering. You understand? For them that defile themselves with mankind. For men stealers. For liars, for perjured persons. Don't they say that in court? They say perjury is a crime. Don't commit perjury. You sign certain legal documents that have a legal context to it. They say for any misrepresentation of information herein, you will be such and such and such and such, so on and so on. In other words, you have perjured yourself. Perjured because you stepped into the square and you saying, yes, I admit, but then you act like a hypocrite. You understand? That's a perjured person. And it says, if there be any other thing that is contrary, if there's anything else that is contrary to karni, you understand, contrary, opposite to sound doctrine, doctrine again. The word sound here needs to be understood. If you have a Schofield, then look to the subscription N, as in niggles, N, and you will see that there's another link here, I think, where are we at right here? There's another link here to 2 Corinthians 2 and 17, but I'm just going to shorten that path for you a little bit by saying that sound doesn't mean sound like you hear my voice and you hear sound. It's not sound in that sense. It's saying sound in the sense of healthy. In other words, sound doctrine. Right? Sound doctrine. We'll put this right here by the southward side of the tabernacle. Actually, I wrote sound. Look at that. Sound. Right? Sound doctrine. Right? Sound doctrine equals healthy. Right? Equals healthy teaching. Right? Healthy teaching. Don't we always talk about health as Rastafari? Original Rastafari, true Rastafari? Everything about health, not just health in body, but also psychological, you know, health in Christ, Yeshua, the Savior of I and I soul, right? Health spiritually, you understand? A healthy spirituality. It's about healthiness. So right here it says that if there's anything that's contrary to sound doctrine, to sound teaching, to healthy teaching, that's why the law is there. That's why Torah is there. It's there for those sort of things. You understand what you're saying? Outside of the machzor, outside of society, outside of the church, outside of the Rastafari kibbutz or the community, right? Outside, that which is on the outside, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust, and I thank the Moshiach, Yeshua, our Lord, Adonenu, who has enabled me for that he counted me faithful. So we say we study, why do we study in Shahs of Approval? We study in Shahs of Approval so that, by and by, Yeshua, the Father, Abba, would count us faithful. And then he would reveal to us, and we will see that revelation actually manifest as Hawali Apollos is saying here to his disciple, Timotheos, Timothy, where he was counted, he was numbered, like the book of Numbers, numbered, he was accounted faithful, and he was put into the ministry. What's the ministry? The Agel Galot. He was put into the service. So when many of y'all say, what can I do? What can I do? There's five things that y'all can do, of course. You understand? But when we're talking about the ministry, it's very important that we understand the foundation. You understand? Because if you understand the foundation and learn how to use the tools that has been given to us, we will grow, we will build, we will progress. All right? And Paul goes on to say this. And, you know, as you become, as you grow, and you really are able to really look into the law as looking into the mirror, you begin to recognize how beautiful it is that Hawadi Apollos even testifies to this way. He goes on in verse 13, verse 1, 3, verse 13 to say, he was put into the ministry, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer. He was before a blasphemer, like there's a lot of these ones who are blasphemers of the King of Kings. They are blasphemers of Ketamari Haile Selassie. I'm not saying that all of them will be put into the ministry. They'll be put somewhere, but I'm not going to say they'll be put into the ministry. But Paul is saying for himself that he before was a blasphemer. He was a persecutor. Because the very same thing that he fought against when he had that that encounter, you understand, or that incident, as is recalled in Acts of the Apostle. You see, that turned him around. He had a situation that really woke him up. You understand? But he was a persecutor before, and injurious, and he hurt folks. Paul, I mean, you see, we read this, we don't really understand that Paul was like a bad boy for the Pharisees. You understand? He would go out there, like the bad boy for whatever that cult or that clique of Judaism was. And we have, you know, a little bit of this going on here and there at the same time in the world, and even somewhat even in Rastafari. But he's saying that he was a blasphemer, persecutor, injurious, but I obtained mercy. He obtained mehiret. He obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. He did it without the true faith. He didn't have the true interpretation of the Ritua Haimanot. He believed he did. This is why he persecuted the Christian, like there's many of those who persecute the Rastafari, who believe that they are doing God's service. But they are basically idiotes, they're ignorant, and they're doing it because they don't have the true faith. This is what Paul is saying. He did these things ignorantly. That's why in Judaism, from Torah 101, where it says that when the Almighty Adonai created the world, he created the world in justice. He created it by the circle and the square. You understand? Squaring the circle, as some people say, or circling the square, as other folks might say, right? But he created it based on justice and judgment. But that was too much. Even he overstood in his foreknowledge and forethought that he had to have mercy above judgment, and mercy, his mercy had to modify that judgment. And that's kind of very interesting in that sense that Paul, who overstood the Kabbalah, the Kevlar, no doubt he overstood that too. He was on the side of the tree that was called severe. And he moved to the side of the tree that was called mercy. And his continued ministry and all that he suffered, even of his own people, his own clique, you understand, like we suffer some of our own so-called rosters, but they'd be like, Rastafari is not a religion, because this one and that one and next one. What about what his majesty say? You know, but when the government is established, you can't run around and be doing that. For real, you can't. See, now they can do it because none of these false courts and grudges in the world are going to take them to task. And even likes when these Decepticons go out there, because they make it bad for our mothers and daughters and wives and brethren and families and those who really seek to do the will of God in Christ. And the grace of Geatachin, of Adonenu, was exceeding abundant with faith and love. He didn't just say, like a lot of you all might say, love and peace. No, with faith. With the true faith, the Imnet, the Haimanot, the Amen. Right? With what? Faith and love, which is in Christos, the Moshiach, Yeshua. And this is the faithful saying, and worthy of all acceptation. That means worthy of all who accept this, worthy of being accepted, that Christ Yeshua, that the Moshiach Yeshua, that Christos Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Now people say, well, everybody sins. Yes, of course. But you have those in that Yeshua, he saves his people from their sin. Now his people, like Paul, for example, who was one of his people, is not able to admit that, yes, he came to save ones like, save them from what? Save them from themselves, from their own way of, their way. You understand? They were not doing Yah's way, they were doing their own way, going their own way. And he said he was chief of them. Howbeit, for this cause I obtained mercy. He says, it's because of this. Not because of any of these other reasons, what kind of food I ate, or what kind of clothing I wore, or what kind of sessions I went to, or what kind of Jew I said I was. Paul's not saying any of that. He just, howbeit, for this cause I obtained mercy, in that in me first, Jesus HaMoshiach.